Thanks for joining me. I'm Julie Philipp. The image of the Finger Lakes can be one of luxury and relaxation. Fine wines, beautiful views, the good life. But behind that image is a lot of hard work and dedication in the face of occasional hard times, thanks to Mother Nature. WXXI's Steve Dawe explains how one family's livelihood was nearly wiped out in a 10-minute hailstorm that was so localized their next-door neighbors were barely touched.
Now, what kind of grape is this?
This is Cayuga White. It's a grape Cayuga developed White. By Cornell University, and this vineyard was the first commercial planting of it.
Tom Challen knows grapes, and as a vineyard owner and winemaker, he's also a farmer, so that means he knows weather. But he'd never seen anything like he did here at Cayuga Ridge Estates on May 29th of this year.
Now, a storm came over the hill from this way?
Yes, came from the west. Northwest, strong winds, heavy rain. And I was at our house office, and then I heard the pinging of the hail, and it's very distinctive. And the first wave wasn't too bad, and I was pretty sure we were going to survive that. And then the second wave was a lot larger hailstones and more intense and heavy winds.
To the untrained eye, the storm damage isn't even visible, really. There are no massive tree trunks snapped by hurricane-force winds or even downed tree limbs. But look a little closer, and the damage is there, and it's devastating.
There is the beginnings of grapes here still.
Yes, yes, there's enough energy in the vine to set the fruit, so we have some. But instead of just being one cluster here, every one of these shoots would have two clusters.
Oh, wow.
So there's a big loss.
The loss was documented by photos taken by his insurance company just after the storm. A storm that amazingly hit Cayuga Ridge, but only slightly damaged small portions of the vineyards of other wineries right next door. Insurance helps, but it's a poor substitute for what Mother Nature can do.
Will these be able to be salvaged? Are you hopeful?
Yes. It looks like it's been weakened at this point of the stem, but the size of the berry right now looks like it would mature okay. But you know, there should be at least two for every one of these shoots along here to have a full crop. And we have one on that whole cane, and there's another one or maybe three over on this cane.
From one, you're expecting maybe 20 or 30 normally?
40.
Yes. 40.
40. We have 20 buds, and each bud have two clusters, so there should be 40. Good 40 clusters or more.
What is your estimate for how much you have lost of your crop?
At this point, I think we're between 75% and 85% total loss of the crop, but basically 100% in two varieties.
What varieties?
This Cayuga White and our Chardonnay, right in this area here.
Scars of the storm are visible on the vines and imprinted on Tom Challen's memory.
What goes through your mind at that point?
Well, it's a difficult emotional blow because you've put a lot of effort into getting to the grapes at this stage. We've pruned them, we've tied them, which is a big part of the expense for the year. And I think, well, how are we going to survive if we don't have a crop? But after we came out and surveyed it, and my wife was pretty upset too about it because we worked very closely together on this, on the land. And I realized we have good quantity of grapes or wines in the cellar. We have some good tanked wines, some wines in barrels, different vintages. And I'm pretty sure we'll be okay. We won't be out of the marketplace. We will have wines on our shelf all the time, continuously, so.
Challen is not sour about his damaged grapes. His long history in winemaking has impressed upon him the need to prepare for that rainy day. Even if it arrives in the form of a devastating dose of hailstones, the evidence is found in Cayuga Ridge Estates production facilities.
Well, one of the things is that we've retained other vintages, partial amounts of other vintages, both in bulk in the tanks and in the barrels. So we have some a large quantity of Cayuga White, which is nice, which I was going to sell some of it, but we will keep it now for our own use in wine production, wine bottling. Yes,
the challenge to make quality wine is what keeps the juices flowing for Challen and his staff.
60-40 Chardonnay heavy.
Like many winemaking families in the Finger Lakes, the Challens have learned the lessons of diversification when it comes to business. In addition to producing wine, they host group outings, live music events, and have opened a popular wood-fired pizza restaurant. Multiple revenue streams help produce flexibility and stability.
We're thankful for our strengths within ourselves and the foresight to maintain inventory that allow us to override this. We also have crop insurance, which I'm glad we have. It's a risk management decision to do that. And at times we thought, well, why pay these big premiums? But at times like this, I think it's going to be well worth it. And telling the story of the damage and then how we survive is helping, I think, will help to explain the difficulties of farming in general, working with Mother Nature, and it's part of reality.
And so your message to people is, we're open for business and still going strong.
Correct.
That from WXXI's Steve Dawn. Joining me now in studio is Jim Trezise, president of the New York Wine and Grape Foundation. Thanks for coming in today.
Thank you, my pleasure.
Now, it has been a hard year for a lot of local fruit. We saw problems with the strawberries, the cherries, there's talk of apples. But you're saying the grapes, other than that particular vineyard, grapes are doing okay right now.
Yeah, we've been really lucky this year. And when I ask growers, how's the crop looking, they say better than it should. And the reason for that is, of course, we had the same weather patterns as our friends in the apple industry did and so forth. So we had the very, very warm winter, which is wonderful for humans, but it confuses fruit trees and vines.
And it's not great for grapes either. So you were concerned at one
exactly.
point.
Exactly. And then we had those freezes in the frost in late April and May, and everybody thought that's it, because if the vines start growing and they get frosted, was what we call it, then it basically kills the buds and it kills the crop. But it's quite amazing how the vines have come through it. So maybe overall the damage is up to 10%, but no more.
Mm-hmm. Any idea how come they survived?
Well, and our friends in Chautauqua, Lake Erie region, did not make out so well. They grow Concord, and Concords start growing earlier than the many of the varieties we have here in the Finger Lakes, the vinifera varieties like Riesling or hybrids like Cayuga White and so forth. So it really depended on the state of the vine at the time that it happened. And since we do have some Concords here, but not nearly as much as in Chautauqua. So we just got lucky. And yes. it's a reminder that wine is farming. I mean, first and foremost, and you have good years and challenging years, and you just make the most of whatever you're given.
I was out Pen Yan Way not too long ago, maybe over the weekend, and a lot of the leaves seem to be turning brown on some of the vines. Is there a problem or a concern about drought now due to the lack of rain and the hot weather that we've been having?
We could definitely use some rain. That would be really good. I mean, you take a look at the grass and it's brown, so the leaves are you know, pretty much reacting just the way the grass does. We could just use, you know, some good soaking rainfalls, you know, two or three of them before the harvest starts would be really good, just to replenish the water table in the earth. But you know, we're going to have to be confident that we can make good wines for whatever we're given. And this year is shaping up very much like 2010. We've had the really warm weather. Right now we're about 2 weeks ahead of schedule, which means that we would harvest early, and that's a good deal because you can get the fruit off the vine before there's any danger of a killing frost in October, say. But on the other hand, last year looked like 2010 too, going into Labor Day, and then it started raining. And when you don't want the rain is in the fall. When you do want the rain is between now and Labor Day.
Have you placed your order yet?
Yeah. I wish we could control that.
Does the hot weather, does that affect the quality or the flavor of grapes at all, having, you know, a really warm summer like this?
Yes, it does. I mean, it develops the flavors ahead of schedule. And also, if you end up with a relatively dry season, the grapes, individual grapes, are smaller than they are in a season that's quite a bit wetter. What that means is that a lot of the character of wine comes from the skins of the grapes, especially red wines. So if you have a smaller grape, you have more skin to pulp, and so you have greater flavor. So yeah, there are some advantages to having a reasonably dry year.
And this year, a special one for Dr. Frank's winery there. Can you talk about the anniversary and why that's significant, not just to that particular winery, but to the whole industry here?
Yeah, it was a great event at a great place. And you know, that family, starting with Dr. Frank and then his
50
heirs,
years ago.
50 years ago, started a revolution. And that's not too strong a word, because what Dr. Frank proved is that in the Finger Lakes region and other parts of New York State, you can grow the relatively cold sensitive varieties, European varieties like Riesling and Pinot Noir and Merlot and so forth. Everybody was skeptical at that time, but he proved that it could be done. And as a result, today we now have over 100 wineries in the Finger Lakes region, almost all of which are making Riesling and some other of the vinifer varieties as well. What that also did is it put the Finger Lakes on the worldwide map as a serious wine region. So there's a true legacy there, and he was a transformative character, as were his son and grandson. And
it remains in the family, correct?
Remains in the family, and in fact, the fourth generation, Megan Frank, Fred's daughter, is now studying for an MBA in wine business at the University of Adelaide, Australia, which is a tremendous school. So, yeah, it's all in the family, and they do a great job.
And the 50th anniversary celebration last weekend, it drew some writers and industry people from around, from the nation, correct? Or were there...
Yes, it did. And I had the pleasure, in fact, of escorting one of them for a couple days after that. His name is Kevin Zarelli, and he is the author of the largest selling wine book in the world. It's the complete course, Windows on the World wine course. And he was there because he had actually worked with Dr. Frank 30 plus years ago, grafting vines in a bitter cold garage in the middle of winter. And so he came up, which is a big deal. The head of the wine program at the Culinary Institute of America in the Hudson Valley, he was there, and there were a bunch of other wine writers. And, you know, the Congressman Tom Reed was there, and Patrick Hooker from representing the governor. So, yeah, it was a great celebration.
Well, that's nice to hear. And, you know, we've seen the industry in the Finger Lakes really blossom and grow each year. But that's not just here, is it? Across New York State, we're seeing growth.
It's totally amazing. New York has 62 counties altogether. Now there are 55 counties that have wineries, one or more wineries. So if you take a look at a map by county of New York State and color it light purple, where there's at least one winery in a county, you basically have a purple state. So places that you would never suspect, like the Thousand Islands, the Champlain region, the Greater Adirondacks, we would have never thought, because it's just too cold. But what they're doing is they're planting new grape varieties called Minnesota varieties that were developed in Minnesota for Minnesota.
Good for them.
meaning that they can withstand temperatures of 40 below zero and still produce a crop. There are names that you've probably never heard of called Brianna and Frontenac and Marquette, but they're making some really good wines, and some of the wineries up there, like Coyote Moon, are winning top awards in major competitions. Like, I just got back from San Francisco. They won a top award there with one of their wines. And so it's amazing how the industry has spread. When I came here in 30 years ago, there were about 19 wineries. Today, there are 319 wineries.
So you're keeping a little busier than
yeah,
you
that's
used
for sure.
To. Thank you so much for coming in today.
Oh, thank you.
Jim Trezise, president of the New York Wine and Grape Foundation.